Hi, I'm Marta Halina from the University of Cambridge.
I'm Colin Klein of the Australian National University.
And I'm Andrew Barron from Macquarie University.
As we come to appreciate the wealth and diversity of intelligences on Earth, the challenge becomes how to make sense of this complexity. How can we comprehend it in a systematic way? We argue that one important piece of the puzzle involves treating the evolution of cognition as a series of major evolutionary transitions. Each transition represents a qualitative shift in how information flows within an organism's nervous system. These shifts had profound consequences for what was computationally feasible for organisms with the new capacities for information flow. Our focus on major transitions comes in part because of the utility of the concept in structuring debates in evolutionary biology. In the mid-1990s, the evolutionary biologists John Maynard Smith and Ars Shatmari identified several major evolutionary transitions, which made possible radically different forms of life. These transitions included events such as the origins of eukaryotes and multicellular organisms. Smith and Shatmari emphasized important features of major transitions, for example, that they are contingently irreversible and increase centralized hierarchical control. This means, as the philosophers Brett Calcott and Kim Sterelny observe, quote, "The major transitions model is heuristically powerful, for it forces us to ask important questions about the conditions of change and the stability of those conditions," end quote. We hypothesize that the evolution of cognition can be modeled in a similar way. The purpose of this framework is to explore the validity of this hypothesis. Our proposal is that there are a few important transitions which have shaped the space of what is possible for different kinds of animal minds. Major transitions in cognitive evolution are, fundamentally, changes in the way that information flows through nervous systems to coordinate both internal and external action. These are changes that give organisms qualitatively different possibilities for behavior, for bodily organization, and lifestyle. As our working hypothesis, we propose five major transitions in the evolution of animal cognition, based on prior research in animal cognition. The first important transition occurs when organisms start using neurons to accelerate communication between different parts of their body. We call these relatively undifferentiated nervous systems networks. A network can support the most basic forms of learning, simple associations, sensitization, and habituation. The presence of simple networks allows not just for coordinated action, but also for ongoing modulation of coordinated action by environmental demands. This sort of modulation is found even in unicellular organisms, but nerve nets allow for coordinated and more complex forms of environmental responsiveness. Our second proposed transition is centralization. Tardigrades, the nematode worm, C. elegans, planarian flatworms, simple mollusks like sea slugs, and worms like the medicinal leech all have an organizational plan that centralizes control functions. Centralization allows the outputs of sensors to be combined prior to the output to motor systems. This in turn allows integration of information from a variety of sources and more complex sensors. Centralization, then, enables two radically new forms of information processing, global integration and local specialization. The novel cognitive capacities enabled by a centralized nervous system include the emergence of unified decision systems responding to the sum of all sensory information, and learning expressed across feed-forward neural matrices. This enables new forms of learning, including generalization and classification of information. Complex limbed and differentiated bodies are only possible with a centralized nervous system. We therefore suggest that centralized systems such as these first emerged in the Cambrian period about 500 million years ago. Prior to this, the fossil animals from the Ediacaran period were soft-bodied multicellular organisms with markedly undifferentiated bodies. The Cambrian period saw an explosion in animal body plans, notably featuring complex limbs, different types of limbs, and complex sensory structures. The evolutionary theorists and philosophers Simone Ginsberg and Eva Jablonka argue that the centralization of nervous systems at this time led to a massive increase in adaptive behaviors, such as habitat selection and niche construction. In other words, the move from network to centralization transformed the space of biological possibility, leading to the emergence of great biological diversity. A centralized network is feed-forward with a unidirectional transformation of sensory inputs to outputs. A recurrent network incorporates feedback from later stages into earlier processing. Recurrence is not just feedback, however. Even unicellular and non-neural systems have a form of feedback through the inevitable consequences of actions on their local environment. Recurrent systems incorporate the output of latter stages of processing into earlier stages of processing to change the operation of the system. One benefit of internalized feedback is that it can speed up the operating timeframe of the network. This offers many advantages for coordination and learning compared to the slower, less reliable feedback that can be gained by observing the environment and deducing the consequences of one's actions. Insect brains show recurrence at multiple stages of processing. We argue that this is the reason why insects are capable of prodigious feats of learning, navigation, working memory, and planning. Recent work on insect connectomes emphasizes the degree to which they are dominated by recurrent loops not present in organisms like C. elegans. Organisms with recurrent structures similar to the insect mushroom body, such as the mantis shrimp, also have sophisticated capacities for spatial memory, navigation, and visual recognition. Whether this structure has been phylogenetically conserved or whether mantis shrimps and insects independently underwent a major transition is unclear. What is important for our purposes is that recurrent architectures introduce new forms of learning and behavior and new evolutionary possibilities. A laminated network has interacting and layered recurrent systems. Any subsystem of a network can become laminated. But we are interested in particular in laminated networks that take as their input outputs from a functional sensory motor transformation system and feed these back into that same system. Examples would be structures like the vertebrate cortex or the cerebellum. Lamination allows for representation and control across multiple different time scales, and to combine information across different timescales and from different points in time. Laminated architectures are also easy to expand. The basic pattern of cellular organization underlying laminated cortical structure can be repeated in the form of serial homologs. Indeed, such repeated structures appear to comprise most cortical regions. In computer science, reflection refers to the ability of a program to access and modify its own source code. In theory, reflection allows for unparalleled flexibility, for it allows the informational architecture of a machine to be specified virtually rather than physically. We propose that the fifth transition is the ability to reflect in this general computational sense. We also tentatively suggest that reflection is the computational principle that underlies the sophisticated use of language, higher-order cognitive control, self-awareness, mathematical abilities, and other capacities that seem to set humans apart. It's worth noting that major transitions do not need to be sudden or inevitable or dramatic, nor do transitions necessarily increase what is possible. A multicellular organism has lost certain possibilities that remain open for unicellular creatures. Just as the move from unicellular to multicellular life requires individual cells to work together rather than optimize their individual fates, new forms of brain organization bring new demands and new limits, as well as new opportunities.
Great. Now let's talk a bit about the dynamics of evolutionary change under a transitions model. You can think of different evolutionary frameworks as giving different big picture dynamics to how cognition evolved. And we think of these broadly as falling along a spectrum from what'll be more gradualist pictures over here on the left to saltationist pictures, pictures that involve big, large jumps on the right. So the simplest picture, and the one I think a lot of animal research often still implicitly has, is a very gradualist picture of the evolution of cognition. So in this one, very roughly, you know, you've got brains changing slowly and steadily by adding more resources, generally more brains, more neurons, more synapses, more connections. You might have changes in the kind of inputs and the quantity of processing, but not what's being done. So if you have a very simple picture where everything is associative learning, then really the only things you can change are what are the inputs, what are the sensors, how much brain is there to learn, and what are the outputs, so what kind of motor actions can you have. But there's no difference in processing per se, it's all something like associative learning or reinforcement learning. So the picture of evolution you get is something like the following. So think of the x-axis here as time, the y-axis as something like complexity. A species might very slowly increase in complexity or cognitive capacity over time. It might also not. Note that reversals are possible too. You can gain and lose capacity. And so the dotted line there is something like a hypothetical species that goes along the same process but is under different evolutionary pressures, and so just kind of continues and drifts and never gets more complex and never gets more cognitive capacities overall, but it's the very same kinds of additions over time. Now, this very gradualist picture is something of a limit case. You might think that there's a little bit more structure possible, so currently, hierarchical Bayesian models are very popular. And there you've got, you know, more capacity and maybe also a few more levels in the hierarchy could be added. But in general, the gradualist picture says there are one or a handful of types of process and then, you know, more resources devoted to them in some way or another. Contrast that with a modularist view, which says that brains change in multiple but small discrete jumps. So in other words, you add new types of process, new special purpose modules, in order to deal with new kinds of challenges. And again, these can be added or lost as needs permit. So the picture looks very similar, but now rather than a very steady, you know, upwards or decline or meander, what you have are sort of big little jumps here and there. Environmental pressures cause the need to add or subtract modules, and these modules are thought of as, you know, special purpose encapsulated little programs that handle, you know, new jobs in the environment or handle new ways of processing information that's already there. Now, strictly speaking, the modular and the gradualist picture kind of work together in the sense that if you've got a modular picture, you can also think that sometimes modules are allocated more resources. That's one of the reasons why it can be hard to decide between them. But in general, although the modular picture talks about jumps, there are lots of very small jumps as new capacities are added or subtracted. Contrast that, what we might think of as a really big picture kind of change. So this is the saltatory models. On saltatory models, what happens is you've got brains evolved by the sudden addition of a wholly new capacity. So here we're taking as a paradigmatic case things Chomsky has said on syntax. So what happens is you've got, you know, all kinds of semi-linguistic, proto-linguistic capacities, but until you get syntax and, you know, in the minimalist program, a very specific sense of the syntactic operations, you don't have language. Once you have that, then language is possible, and then everything that depends on language is also possible. So much of what looks like new capacities, say, for storytelling or maybe self-projection or numeracy, those might just be distinct, like, kind of downstream consequences of the one big jump. So in contrast to these gradual meanders that you saw before, what you have is that you think of red as having one particular kind of capacity, and you've got one big jump, and then you can do all kinds of new things. Whereas, you know, the dotted line is the species without the big jump, and if you don't hit the big jump, you never get any better. Now, the way we've been thinking of the transitions framework is somewhere intermediate between a modular and a saltatory view. So the idea is that occasionally you get relatively large jumps. These are major transitions. But unlike the saltatory views, where the big jumps are the addition of wholly new capacities, major transitions are something more like an alteration of the form of information flow within brains, which means that they don't add new capacities per se. In fact, around the time of a transition, you should expect organisms that have made the transition and organisms that haven't to be roughly equivalent, and sort of like what you find in a gradualist or modular picture. What happens, however, is that after the transition, new forms of complexity are possible. So in the third from the left here, what you have is the red is pre-transition. Things meander along, but if something happens to make the transition, more and more possibilities for a complex cognition are possible. Now note, on this view, the dotted red line, the one that doesn't do the transition, can still keep up with the blue for a while. So transitions don't automatically give you an advantage in the way that you find on the saltatory views. Instead, the advantage is over time, more complex cognition becomes possible, and ultimately that entrenches the transition and makes the downstream consequences very powerful. Now, there are several reasons to like the transitions framework. One is simply because it provides a nice balance between the, sudden and often inexplicable jumps that you find on a saltatory view and the kind of difficulty of figuring out how you would get the richness and complexity of what we actually observe on a gradualist or modular view. We also think that the focus on evolvability of cognitive mechanisms is particularly important. So this not adding completely new capacities, but rather adding the possibility for evolving new capacities. It also gives, we think, an important way of thinking about how these transitions might occur. So think about, for example, with recurrence. What happens is you might have information flows that go, for example, external to the body in one organism that become internalized in another organism. So this might be an initially fairly minor change. It might just be a matter of taking recurrent loops that go through the environment, bringing them closer and closer in until you have some of the recurrent loops going through neural tissue instead. That might come with costs, that might come with trade-offs. So it's not obvious that right after a transition, the organism is any better off. However, what happens is that initially minor change in the actual information flow ends up becoming entrenched in ways that permit large changes in what's possible for the descendants of the system. So the transition frameworks really gives you this balance between, on the one hand, the evolutionary plausibility of the more gradualist stories with the ability for real and lasting change that you see in the saltationist stories.
So what are the experiments and what are we actually doing? In terms of the experiments proposed and what we have underway, if our transitions framework is right, we should be able to make some decent predictions. If we are seeing a transitional model, we should see different types of intelligence. And we should see interesting limits to the intelligences of different animal groups. And we should be able to propose why those specific limits should exist. Now, the transitions framework is incredibly broad, but in our experimental work, we're focusing on comparing insects with vertebrates. Vertebrates, we're proposing, have a laminated type of brain. Insects, we're proposing, have a recurrent type of brain. Now, we would predict there should be different limits to the intelligence of the insects and the vertebrates, and that's really what we're testing in the experimental work. We're focusing on the limits in learning relationships, and I talked previously about work I'd done looking at learning of abstract concepts in insects, which is very good work and is certainly robust and a repeatable finding. And I talked previously how honeybees can solve a delayed match-to-sample task and a delayed not-match-to-sample task, and they can generate that relationship to new concepts, which has been considered to be learning of the concepts of sameness and difference. And we proposed a model that is compatible with the insect brain that could support that capacity and could explain how insects are solving this type of task. But an interesting limit that's proposed by this model and is backed by experimental findings is that there is a temporal limitation to learning relationships in insects. And in insects, this capacity to recognize sameness and difference is limited to the visual working memory of the insect. Now, that limit doesn't apply to some of the vertebrates. So certainly macaques don't have that limit. Humans don't have that limit. So what's interesting here is we do have a suggestion that there are different limitations on the types of intelligence of insects and vertebrates, and we want to explore that limit in more detail. Now that means we've got to compare learning behavior, behavior in learning assays across species, and we know that's always difficult because of problems of making sure the assay is actually a fair task for all of the species, problems with standardizing the motivation and the state of the participants in the task so that if we see a difference, we can reasonably say the difference is due to a difference in cognitive capacity or intelligence and not due to a difference in motivation or ability to take part in the task or some motor or sensory limitation that would limit their capacity in the task. And this is really, really hard. But our approach here is we're focusing our studies on pollinators, vertebrate pollinators, and we're using the red-throated hummingbird, and bee pollinators, the honeybee and the bumblebee. And we're focusing on pollinators because these are all animals that are highly visual. They are extremely rewarded and reinforced by small droplets of sugar, and they find bitter solutions aversive. So we can use the same types of reinforcer. And they should have evolved to a similar sort of ecological challenge of finding droplets of sugar in flowers. So hopefully we have similar types of motivation in these animals. But really, to try to standardize the motivation, in all of our tests, we have an open arena. So the animals themselves choose when they will take part in a task. And we're hoping that normalizes the motivational state of the organisms because they themselves are choosing when to participate. So we're focusing our comparisons across vertebrates and insects on pollinators in the hope that that will solve many of the motivational problems that plague this kind of comparison. The task that we're using to explore the learning of relationships is a delayed conditional discrimination task. In the task, the animal has to learn to associate one of three stimuli with reward, one with punishment, and one as a distractor stimulus that just offers water. That contingency of which stimulus is rewarded is set by a conditional cue the animal sees as it enters the arena. So it sees it the conditional cue on entering the arena, but that cue is not present in the arena. So it has to hold in working memory the cue if it's to correctly learn the context and correctly solve the task. And what we've used in these assays are cues and stimuli that we know are really well and really rapidly learned by our focal species. Now, this work is ongoing, but the data that we have so far shows that all of our species, the hummingbird, data in pink, the honeybee, data in gold, and the bumblebee, data in black, all of them can learn this task, and actually all of them learn it to a kind of similar level of performance. But the insects are acquiring the task faster than the hummingbirds. Now, we're still looking into this. We've got some ideas why this might be. What is intriguing about this is this lines up with something that has been hinted at for quite a while. In a lot of the tasks that are set to insects and where there are comparable tasks in vertebrates, we do see faster acquisition in the bees. But of course, no task prior to this has set itself up as an explicit comparison. So it's interesting to me that in this explicit comparison, we see this phenomenon of, but I'll say for now, potentially faster acquisition in an insect compared to a vertebrate. Now, we're exploring this and we're exploring why this might be
if it's genuine. And this is a point I'd actually like to discuss with the group in this summit. And then lastly, wrapping up so we keep this nice and short, I want to talk about how this transitions project could connect to other bodies of work. Now, we've considered transitions as changes in information flow through an organism. And we're not saying that's limited to nervous systems, but we have been, to be fair, thinking a lot about animal nervous systems. So an open question for us is, what about before networks? Our sort of baseline is transition one, formation of networks. But what about before networks? What are the capacities of organisms that don't have networks? And I think that's a really, really interesting question that is above my pay grade and is not something that we're planning to address in this project. But I hope that this is a point where other work could connect with this framework. Similarly, something that really, really interests us, but is way above our pay grade, is that are the transitions that we're talking about general, or are they specific to nervous systems that involve animal-type neurons? So we're quite interested in the constraints that neurons impose on networks. Neurons can be really noisy and they're very costly, and signals degrade really quickly in neural networks. And silicon-based computational networks, rapidly talking beyond expertise here, don't have those kinds of constraints, but might have different kinds of constraints. And a really interesting question would be how constraint might interact with or shape transitions. And this again is, I think, where different kinds of work could connect and could really help to refine this kind of project. Another area where this project has enormous room to develop and advance is the difficult fifth transition, which we're currently calling reflection, and which we've talked about as reflection in that computational sense. But it's clear that reflection is, if it is a transition, is a transition that is not structural in the same way the other ones are structural. And there's an open question as to what that means, how we handle reflection, and really what reflection is and how to think about it and what's important in reflection. And there are people, I'm sure, who are way better qualified to address those kinds of questions than us. So that's a really quick intro to this proposal of an exploratory hypothesis for a transitional model for the evolution of intelligence. And that's really what it is. It is an exploratory hypothesis. And I hope that, if nothing else, it'll stimulate some really interesting conversations that might help us refine that hypothesis.